When you first read Frankenstein's Monster, what was your experience of it? Because I know, not that I should talk about myself first.
No.
When I read it, I had this idea of some kind of a sort of gothic horror fiction story. And I was just struck by the sentimentality and the pathos of it.
Yes. Yeah, you were expecting something else.
Yeah.
I just realized when I read it, I realized that, oh, this is the kind of book that you can't lie about having read. You know, some books you can lie. You can say like, oh, Count of Monte Cristo, yes, about this and this. And then you've read the whole summary, so it's fine. But you can't lie about having read Frankenstein. Because everyone gets it wrong.
Yeah.
Everyone thinks the monster is Frankenstein. The monster is just a nameless monster.
Yeah, because it's so sentimental, that whole sorrow of the monster. It has nothing to do with any of those movies you've seen where it's just this, well, literal monster that is only evil out to kill people. And I think that was what struck me the most, that sort of the heartache, the pain of the monster.
Yes. Yeah, and that it's so ugly. And you know, this book is very, you could say that it's very superficial, because most of the reason why the monster is treated the way he's treated is because of the way he looks. And so writing down that in such a poetic way, the way someone looks can be a catalyst for just a catastrophic life. That is the catalyst for everything that happens in that person's life. That's so tragic.
Yeah.
And so, just that's the way it is. Can't do anything about it.
Then you have that famous scene where he confronts Frankenstein. Then talking about his loneliness. And that everybody shuns him because he's so different. I mean, it's kind of like, not to drift into that, but that's a movie I saw when I was like 12, I think, The Elephant Man.
Yeah, I've heard of it.
Yeah, you know, and he has this, this is a real story from early 19th century, and he was, his mother was stepped on by an elephant. She was working in a circus, I think. And so he's completely deformed and has this humongous head. He can't lie down because then his head will fill with fluid or whatever. Anyway. And then there's this amazing scene where he is going through a railway station, and some boys see, okay, here's some guy looking like a stranger. And they take off his paper bag actually that he's wearing. And people are just like, what the hell is going on here? And they follow him. Everybody's sort of, more and more people follow him. They end up in the toilet there, the men's toilet. And he's sitting there and says, I am not an animal. I am a human being. I still remember that.
And it's such an easy sentence.
Yeah.
It's like, that's how it is.
Yeah. And I think that's what happens with the Frankenstein's monster. This thing about being completely different from the society around you.
Yeah, alienated.
And yeah, that's another connection. You know, I'm trying to sort of get everything into sort of the ground mythical narrative.
Yeah.
So here's my cherry picking.
Yeah.
I learned something now just recently from Campbell.
Mm-hmm.
And he talks about, you know, you had this, you had the belief in that the world should end. Like in the year 1000, a lot of people gave their property to the church.
Mm-hmm.
And then it didn't end. And there were a lot of lawsuits to get their property back afterwards. But then he's talking about how that's not the point. The point is that when you see, as he says, when you see the kingdom of the Father spread upon the earth, that it's actual, not something after life, but something that you can attain now through your mental state. Then the world dies for you. It perishes for you. And I think that's also some...
Not for everyone, but for you.
For you, yeah. Or you die from it. And I think the whole idea of myth is that you have this grand sort of exaggerated, quote-unquote, symbols or figures. And I think Frankenstein's monster can fit into that iconology.
It's a very exaggerated symbol. Yeah, yeah. It's an icon sort of.
Yeah.
Yeah. Icon in literature.
Yeah.
Mm.
Because he has that. I mean, he's well read. He reads Plutarch and Goethe and all these things. And he has this great love. He wants to be a part of society, but it society rejects him.
Mm. Based on something superficial.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Right. But have you thought about? Because there's several things you can go into there. I mean,
there's so much symbolism.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A thing I noticed looking at it again now. The fact, for example, as you mentioned, that the monster doesn't have a name.
Mm. Yeah, I think Shelley did that on purpose.
Yeah.
I think because if something or someone is nameless, it makes it more convenient, more possible for the reader to interpret it or to think that it's not a physical entity at all. Maybe, mm-hmm. perhaps, mm-hmm. perhaps it's all in the mind.
Mm-hmm.
As soon as you give that monster a name, then it's a story where it's a monster and it's a person.
Yeah.
But it's nameless, so it can be anything. It can be thoughts, or it's easier to interpret.
Yeah. And you also have this, it's quite near also to talk about the Jungian shadow projection. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Because, I mean, the monster is literally a product of his own mind.
Yes. Yeah, it's a that's true. And I was thinking about my interpretation of him creating the monster was based on what I knew from Mary Shelley before. Because I read about her life, her entire life, before reading Frankenstein.
Okay.
Yeah. So I was picturing that all the time and thinking that this was a product from her life. So it's a very good way of doing it.
Well, how would that be? Like using the lived experience as the same?
Yes, I was like reading my own. I felt like I have this thing where I can just dive into someone's biography so much. I feel like I'm them.
Uh-huh.
So I felt like I was reading my own work sort of because I had just read so much about Mary Shelley.
Okay.
Like this is what came out of it. So.
But what's the connection with the biography or her biography then?
Well, the connection I found, which I don't think many people have found, was that Frankenstein, who created the monster, he has many similarities to her husband, Percy. Which is a bit grotesque, but her life was very grotesque. So, because around that time when she wrote that book, Percy was going through a lot of tragedy. So Percy had a wife when he met Mary Shelley, and he had a child, and that wife even had a child on the way. But he completely dismissed that life and kept on living with Mary Shelley. And around the time when Mary Shelley was writing Frankenstein, his wife killed herself with his child.
Mm-hmm. Pregnant.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so that was a result of him neglecting responsibility to live a free, frivolous life. And in many ways, Frankenstein is the result, he creates the result of neglecting responsibility.
Yeah. That's interesting.
Yeah.
That is a physical manifestation of his mental destruction or negligence of the, because in that book his fiancée Christina, what was her name again?
Elizabeth.
It's like he goes on these long trips or is it's like away from her really quite a long time at long periods of time. And I think if you do that to a person you're together with, then you're making sort of a monster, or you're creating a distance. You're destroying could destroy that relationship.
Yes, you create a monster by neglecting responsibility.
Yeah.
And what Victor Frankenstein did was that he did that. He just locked himself up in his laboratorium, and only focused on him and his invention. Yeah. And it was a very narcissistic experience.
It kind of a sort of Uncle Scrooge.
Yes.
Figure them.
Yes, very much.
Uh-huh.
And then the demon came, you know, he created a monster from neglecting his family's love.
Yeah.
His father in the book was always talking about that he should nurture the family and come back to the family. And everyone wrote to him, can you please come back to the family? And he rejected it. He just wanted to create this magic piece of art, you know. And that's exactly what Percy experienced in his life.
Uh-huh.
He loved Mary Shelley and he loved writing poems for her. And it was all very narcissistic. And he thought that he could only write poems if he was with her and all of this. And then he neglected his family. And then he created a monster because he went into a huge depression when his wife killed herself with his child, obviously.
Yeah, but that's the monster.
Yeah, but it's a double-edged sword because Mary Shelley was the one who got together with him. But she knew she was doing a bad, that he was ruining his life for her. Mm.
Thank you for checking out this clip from The Cave of Apelles. If you want to see the entire segment, become a $5 patron at patreon.com/caveofapelles and access all our Dark Flame videos, masterclasses, and bonus material with our guests.